party teaches that class. The party, in a way, is an organization that learns and teaches Marxism to itself. In other words, you know, Marxism is not simply a science. Marxism is a science. Let's be clear about it. Don't want to miss something. Marxism is, understand me. But because Marxism is a science that leads to action, right? Not like astronomy. Astronomy doesn't lead to any action. You see me say there will be the eclipse of the moon next Thursday at 11 o'clock at night, whatever it is. You are not doing anything about it. It is not true. You put a vote here. Who is for the eclipse of the moon next Thursday? If it comes, it comes. If it doesn't come, it doesn't depend on you and me. Marxism is a guide to action. Because a guide to action, it is also an art. You see, science is the law, the Newton law of gravity is a science. You know, you're at school, you learn it, it accelerated velocity increases 5 meters per second, 5 seconds, 5 meters, 25 meters, 125 meters in a third second, etc. Oh, that's absolutely true. If you want to, absolutely true, if you want to throw a stone in the head of a policeman at this rate, Newton law is not enough. You need some training. In other words, it is an art. And therefore, if somebody reads the whole of Marx, and he reads Marx Capital, and he reads it, and he reads it, and he reads it, I'll tell you what you get at the end. Piles. That's guarantee you'll get piles. But if you know how to use it, that's a totally different story. Therefore, Marxism is an art. If it is art, you have to bloody learn it. And you learn it by experience, by trying, by making mistakes, by trying. And therefore, the revolutionary party is the university of the working class. You see, the capitalist class didn't need the university because they were born in the university. You see, in 1789, when the French Revolution came, you see, the capitalists could turn out to the feudal lord and say, all right, you nobility, what do you have? Land. We have capital. We have factories. We have banks. We are richer than you. As a matter of fact, when you are in trouble, what do? You try to get my daughter to marry you. You want to marry, mix your blue blood with my gold. So economically, I mean, we are stronger than you. Intellectually, we are stronger than you. What the hell do you have? Peace and the Bible. We have professors in the encyclopedia. So don't bloody tell us that you are lacking confidence. You have more confidence than us. We have more confidence than you. We are more proud than you. And that's why in the French Revolution, you remember what happened when l'État général met, right, the three estates, it was members of the nobility and members of the priesthood joined the third estate. The third estate was the middle of the capitalists. It is not the other way around. Now, with us, under capitalism, the picture is different. It is not true that we can turn around to the capitalists and say, hey, Ford management, you own those factories, we own other factories. That's not true. And by the way, if Ford management is in trouble, they don't rush to look for a shop steward to marry their daughter. I don't think that's not the answer. You know, intellectually, of course, I believe there is one capitalist, three socialist worker. There must be, by the law of probability, one capitalist. But I think there was more than one worker reading the Sun. You know, the one line of influence is the other way around. Then when it comes to confidence, the party, the revolutionary party, is the university of the working class. And we need this institution because when Marx says in the Communist Manifesto, communists generalize from historical and international experience of the class, you can't do it by your own experience. Even I'm old. I was not very active in the Paris Commune in 1871, believe it or not. I was not in France. So I can't really learn. I need an institution that teaches me about the Paris Commune and other experiences, that the party is the university of the class. What else I want to say about the party? There must be consistent democracy. So people say, why you need centralism? I'll tell you, you need democracy for two reasons. First of all, let's be clear why we need democracy. We need democracy because we don't know what to do. If you always know what to do, you don't need democracy. You need a good telephone. If I could phone Marx and say, hello, Charlie, what should you do in the RMT dispute? I don't need democracy. He'll phone me back and say, the only trouble, they cut his telephone line. He didn't pay for the telephone. No, you know, you need democracy because you don't know what to do. You see, if you want to go from here to Birmingham, you know what you need? You need a bus, you need a busman, and you have to go on the M1 and the M5, if I'm not wrong, or M6, M5. There is no question of discussing. Should we go to the north? Should we go to the south? Should we get M3? Should we get M4? Don't be bloody stupid. We have done it millions of times. We went from London to Birmingham. So you need a bus and a busman. And don't put it to the vote. There's no value to sit in a bus and say, who believe we should go to the north? Who should Birmingham is in the south? Who think we should have a lot of bloody... The thing is known. If you go on the climbing the Everest, if you come or you go in the jungle and you have never been there before, there is nobody that says, you know, you must go to the left. No. You go to the left, you make mistake, you return, reverse, you go to the right, you go up, you make mistake, you go back. In other words, in reality, democracy is because we don't know the bloody answer. And above all, why we don't know the answer, because in the element, the equation, the most important thing is what workers are ready to fight for. That's why I always laugh. There was an organization in Britain, WRP. They issue a statement every bloody second week. General strike! General strike! General strike! They never ask that. The workers, are you ready for general strike? Do you want a general strike? You see, as a matter of fact, if I sit at home and I dream on what car I would like to have, I lie in bed and think, what car I would like to have? I would like to have a Rolls-Royce gold-plated one. To be honest, I never dream of lying in bed and say, you know what I would like? A Klebs Ford 1956. That's my aim in life. If you want to buy a real car, you look around, how much money is in there? You raise £400. For £400, you can have Ford 1956. Right? In reality, therefore, if you come and say, what do you like? I want general strike. To be honest, I don't want general strike. I want a revolution in Britain. I don't want a revolution in Britain. I want a world revolution. I don't want a world revolution. I want the dying of the way of the state. I want a complete disappearance of class society. Of course, if you want to be practical, you say, what the hell can you do? I can collect 20 people to go on strike. I can raise money in support of strikes. Something much more elementary. Therefore, because of that, because we believe you have to learn, because you don't know exactly how far you can go. You need really democracy. How far you can go. So why the hell do we need centralism? We need centralism for two basic reasons. Because first of all, the ruling class is highly centralistic. And if they are centralistic, you have to be the centralist because you have to be symmetrically to them. I always believe you have always to be symmetrical to your enemy. There is no good at all. If the enemy uses sticks, I use a quotation from Marx Capital. Marx Capital is quite good, it's heavy. You can use it on his head. But if he uses violence, you have to use violence. You have to be symmetrically. The ruling class is highly centralistic. Highly, they are like that, like a fist. If they have a fist, we have to have a fist. I've never been a pacifist, because to be honest, I never understood the idea of the meek will inherit the earth. Who the hell wants to eat dust? No, I believe you. I don't want to be meek, I want to be a fighter. And therefore, if they are centralistic, I have to be centralistic as much as them. There is no bloody alternative. But people say, yes, but a revolutionary party like that is not the image of what socialism is about. Of course, you are right. The revolutionary party is a weapon, is an instrument. The instrument never reflects the final product. To produce Venus de Milo, right, a beautiful statue of Louis de Milo, you don't need a hammer looking like Venus de Milo. You need a hammer probably made of iron, ugly hammer that you use to produce the Venus de Milo. You know, the party doesn't prefigure socialism. We are not prefiguring socialism. We are an instrument in the struggle for overthrowing capitalism and established workers' power. And this is why we need democracy and we need centralism in the revolutionary party.